morning paper, sir, my name is Jimmy Brown. Everybody knows that I'm a newsboy of the town. You can hear me yelling morning star on it along the street. Got no hat up on my head, no shoes up on my feet.
On November 8th, 1981, the Sunday New York Times weighed about 4 pounds, give or take a couple of ounces. It included 10 sections and 3 supplements. Those 10 sections and 3 supplements added up to 712 pages. And remember, the Christmas season, not yet. We have with the Sunday New York Times a weekly reminder that the American economy lives and runs on waste. And the New York Times reflects it and utilizes it, and in its own practices carries on the same wasteful practices. Let us examine what we have in this massive 712 pages, which would be, if put in a book form, a very heavy tome indeed. The first section, 88 pages or so, in 2 parts, it's difficult to find the news. 3/4 of the materials are advertisements. And the news, which we may get back to, doesn't add up to very much, considering that you have an entire world to cover. But let's pay some attention to the paper's part that has a very national renown. Let's examine the New York Times Sunday Magazine section. 168 pages in itself. A very good size paperback, to say the least. And what does the New York Times Magazine do? It gives us an agenda of what to think about, and it also gives us a standard around which to organize our lives. Let's see what it includes. I counted, excluding the special features, 8 articles. Now, that in itself is not as simple as you might think, because just to get through these 168 pages is a pretty deceptive business. Getting, in fact, to the very first article, excluding, again, 1 or 2 one-page features, one has to plow through 35 pages of crystalware. One has to plow through bathing suit ads, all kinds of expensive liquors, all kinds of clothing, all kinds of household gadgets, certainly the automobile ads, certainly, of course, there is the omnipresent types of all clothing materials and the luxury goods appealing to the influentials who read this paper. But when you finally get to the first article, it's about, in its own title, how stable are the Saudis? That's a good question. The Saudis are our friends, and if the Saudis aren't stable, we may have another Iran on our hand. So here is the New York Times telling us to be a little bit more prudent than we were in Iran, and in a few other places that we, as the expression goes, lost because in the Saudi case, we have just one extended family running the whole show. Well, after the Saudi article, that's a little heavy going. So we move on to the second article in the magazine section. And that's for some relaxation, although it's got a scientific basis. It's how to measure your tennis strokes with all sorts of very up-to-date measurement scientific devices. Getting on to the third article, we have to plow through another 30 pages of the kinds of ads we've been talking about. The impressive, again, furs, cards, crystal, booze, and what have you. And the third article, again, brings us to one of the main functions of the New York Times. That's to legitimate our political process, to make respectable individuals and programs and processes that are losing their legitimacy in the public. So on Article 3, we have a philosophical discussion, an essay written by Walter Mondale, who some may even remember as the vice president in the former Carter administration. And why do we have this article? No one can say, except that the Times is already 2.5 years before the elections of 1984, beginning to create the kinds of legitimacy, the kinds of credentials for individuals who, from any other standard, any other criteria, would have no particular legitimacy. But to the extent that we have a full article and a long discussion written by Mondale or whoever writes his material, we are already being given the sense that this person is presidential timber. Whether or not that is accurate is a very different story. Then we go on to the fourth article. This is a neutral article. It's about architecture and actually has some very important points to make about the characteristics of New York architecture. But the one characteristic that's missing from the article is the political economy of the entire real estate situation in New York City and in our other large cities. Missing from the article is the role of New York City as the entrepôt of an international, transnational business system, which requires the kinds of architecture that's being written here almost entirely, not entirely, but almost so, from some sort of an aesthetic, formalistic sense. And after we're finished with that article, we move on, and you might have known it, we couldn't get through an issue without being told that there is a case to be made for nuclear energy. You know, all of those demonstrations going on in Europe, all of those hundreds of thousands of people in the streets, the American public must be wondering. So here we have the reassurance brought to us by one of the members of the Times editorial board, no less, to tell us that there is a case for nuclear energy. And let me read you just one of the comments, which I think is very appropriate not only for this article, but for the entire character of what's presented to us at all times. This is Mr. Roger Starr in his article, The Case for Nuclear Energy, writing, and I quote, "Many Americans have winced at the accusation that with 5% of the world's population, the United States uses 30% of its total energy. Are American hogs using too much energy? Or, as it seems to me more likely, does the rest of the world use too little energy because it has not yet achieved a standard of living that satisfies its people?" And so here we have the justification for the gross waste, and not looking inward to say we are hogs, because that would be pretty difficult to tell the New York Times after giving them 702 pages of hoggishness that those who read are becoming hogs. We turn it around and say the rest of the world wants to become hogs, and we're going to help them if we can, but they damn well better not grab our resources, because we've got people out there in the Middle East who make sure they won't do that. Now that's again pretty heavy going. So then we get into another article, we get an article, the sixth article as I count it, on doctors or doctors in training who are piling up personal debts anywhere from $50,000 to $80,000 to complete their training. And the people who write about that are concerned. This is a heavy mortgage for a young doctor to be carrying out into the world. But do we have any discussion of our entire medical system? Do we have any discussion of private medical care? Do we have any discussion why a doctor with an $80,000 mortgage over his head is going to extract every possible penny he may from all the patients who come across his or her path over the next 30 or 40 years of that individual's practice? That's part of a story that deserves a lot of discussion too. And then we move on, because this is already somewhat heavy going to talk about nuclear energy and mortgages on doctors, we have to introduce a little bit of exotica. And so we have an article on mining rubies in Thailand and all of the special characteristics and the frontier activities of that type of very specialized work. Of course, not much mention is made of Thailand as a U.S. base in the South Pacific, as a place where we use to disrupt all types of peaceful actions and make sure that the area remains a point of instability and constant tension. And then finally, we move, and I'm not quite sure it's finally because I get lost in all these pages and all these ads myself, but finally we move to another article titled "The Big Spill of Fall Furs." And this article in itself is interesting because the entire issue is filled with similar materials. And the question that comes up when you look at this particular piece is it an article or is it a commercial? Is it an advertisement for furs or is it an article about furs? Well, these are the pieces that appear in just the magazine section which creates the general agenda for our attention and our behavior. When I come back, I'll talk about a few of the other sections in the New York Times, and in particular, the book review section.
I sell the morning paper, sir. My name is Jimmy Brown. Everybody knows that I'm a newsboy of the town. You can hear me yelling morning star on it along the street. Got no hat upon my head, no shoes upon my feet. Morning paper, sir, my name is Jimmy Brown. I'm off a cold and hungry, sir, my clothes is mighty thin. Wander about from place to place, my daily bread to win.
Now we come to the November 8th New York Times book review. Again, must remember, this is not just one component in a newspaper that happens to be available in New York City and has a large circulation in New York City. The New York Times book review is sent all over the nation. It's used and read and serves as a standard of information and an accounting of what should be the areas of attention in the literary field, and is basically a guide for book acquisitions in libraries around the country, to say nothing of serving in the same way for our book reading public. So it's rather important to know, what is this book review? On this particular day, there were 56 pages in this review. And of those 56 pages, a goodly number were full page, half page, quarter page ads by the major book publishers. That's no surprise. Who are these book publishers who had full page ads? Simon & Schuster, J.P. Putnam, Doubleday, Random House, Dell, McGraw-Hill, St. Martin's, Harcourt Brace Jovanovich, Playboy, the New York Times itself, Morrow, Basic Books, and some others, but these are the big ones. Many of these names some of you will recognize as being more than just publishers. They are parts of much larger conglomerates which own many other kinds of activities, engaged in many other media and non-media fields. But the crucial thing about this is a strictly economic fact. That is that the New York Times is a commercial profit-making operation. And if these are the publishers who take out advertising space in the New York Times book review, it's just good business that it's their books that are going to be reviewed. Now, there are hundreds of other publishers in this country. Most of them are rather small publishers. For those publishers to have attention paid to their books in the New York Times is a very rare event. It does happen, and on occasion there is a review, but I must confess that you will not come across this very often. Now let's just get a couple of perspectives of what this means. In this issue, I counted 20 reviews. If we take this as a standard, and we multiply by the number of weeks in the year, again 52, that means that roughly somewhere around 1,000 books are reviewed. That might vary within 100 or two, but roughly 1,000 books. But 80,000 books are published in this country. Not all of these books, of course, are books that people would want to know about, but a very large number, certainly a far larger number than the 1,000 that are reviewed, are books that a considerable number of people would want to know something about. And so we have here, in this book selection and book review process, one of the crucial control gates in our society. To the extent that a book gets attention, is brought to the attention of potential readers, is reviewed, and therefore comes into visibility, that book has some possibility of being read and circulated and discussed. To the extent that it does not, that possibility diminishes almost to the point of zero, except for specialized magazines and very professionalized journals, which do pick up a little bit, but just a little bit, of this visibility question. And so, the control of the book review section, and in particular the New York Times book review section, is a major cultural influential fact. And those who control that cultural information fact are very much aware of their influence and that power. And it is very, very unusual, not only that small press books will find it very difficult to be seen in the New York Times review section. But just for yourselves, try sometimes to find reviews of books which will give even a moderately fair shake to anything relating to socialism, anything relating to the American labor movement. And, of course, this would be almost unimaginable, a book that might indicate that there was something less than only blemishes in the Soviet Union or Cuba. Now, this is not just something that happens to be random. There are books published in our society. There are authors in our society who write about some of these matters. But this is where one of the crucial control processes enters. We can come back to the New York Times in the control section in another session. Let me go very rapidly over one or two of the other sections that deserve at least passing attention. The travel section. Some of us automatically dump it into the trash can. But the travel section is a place where the consumerist fantasies run wild in the New York Times. Let's just see the first page of Section 10, the travel season. Grand hotels, Los Angeles style. Taos in the snow. What's doing in Denver? A special section in this particular component on the shopper's world. Florence, that's not a woman's name, that's Italy, means the finest in leather goods, and the cost of superb craftsmanship can be surprisingly modest in shops that are a 5-minute walk from the Via Tornabuoni. And all the way down, we are given all of the places where we can eat well, where we can find the finest kinds of hotels, and where we can escape from all of the kinds of problems that sometimes, but only sometimes, get mentioned in the rest of the paper. Along with the travel section, we have the real estate section. Again, it serves some purpose. It does list apartments, houses, real estate. Many of us are searching for some of the things that are listed here. But along with that information, we get testimonials to developers, to builders, to real estate agents, to the financial con men who are rigging and operating and gouging throughout the entire real estate system. And then, not to be less informed, we have the help wanted section. Again, generally regarded as something of use to most of us, or increasingly of use to us as Reaganomics continues to play its role of cutting us out of the labor force. But still, the Times help wanted section, for all its thickness, is quite deceptive. If we open up that help wanted section, we see the enormous role of the war economy. We see the defense contractors. We see the electronics firms. And of course, also a point that deserves far more attention is the legitimacy given to the employment agencies, which, if any of us have had experience with employment agencies, realize these are some of the prime degraders of the human spirit. Well, we could go on. We could go on with the various sections in the New York Times. But for the moment, let us just note that other areas of indoctrination, instruction, cultural governance exist in the arts and leisure section, the business section, and in, of course, that wrap-up of what goes on during the week in review, which if you missed what they were telling you on the other 6 days, they'll come back and give it to you once more in capsule form on Sunday, so you get your poisoning in a more condensed category if you missed it in its more enlarged daily dosage.
Thank you, Herb. That was wonderful.
This is our program.
Talking over, baby, before we start, I heard about the way you overdo your part, so don't you lie to me. Don't you lie to me, baby. Don't you lie to me. You know it makes me mad, and I get as evil as a man. Thank you.
People in Davis, California watch deep dish television.
I don't know.
Why?
Why do we watch deep dish?
I don't know.
You know why?
Because
it keeps us on top of things.